British poetry, MEG 1, selected and expected answers. Wishing you all the best for your upcoming exams. Like the Chaucer's property. Geoffrey Chaucer, 1345 to 1400, was the son of John Chaucer, a wine merchant of London. In 1357, he employed in the service of Lionel, who later on became the Duke Army of Clarence. In 1359, he joined the army of Edward III that attacked France. Chaucer was taken prisoner in this war. His release was arranged through the payment of money. He married Philippa, probably the daughter of Sir Payne Ryot. He was Knight of the Shrine for Kent in 1386 and went on Canterbury pilgrimage in April 1388. And Chaucer's writing will be divided into three periods: his period of French influence, and his period of Italian influence, and his period of maturity from 1836 to 400. Discuss Canterbury Tales as Portrait Gallery. The prologue to the Canterbury Tales has been called a veritable picture gallery by Legos. The various Knargetsen in the prologue are as observed by the author Toff Mankick. Figures in a tapestry, Blake remarked about the variety of characters in this prologue. As Newton numbered the star, as Lynxus numbered the classes of men, Chaucer has varied in the heads and forms of his personages into all nature's variety. He has taken into his compass the various manners and humours of the whole English nation of his age. There is such a variety of characters that Defoleyn remarked, "Here is God's plenty." The 30 or so pilgrims are in fact a fair sample of the society in general, with the exception of the nobility that wouldn't join package tour and the poorest laborers who could not afford to go. Here we have the representative of the church and laity, the persons not representing the church, countryman and townsman, the professions, commerce and the Milton. The framework. The phrase veritable picture gallery implies that the portrait in which appear to the prologue have a design togetherness to the portraits, exist as a part of unity. So it is an exterior framework of a pilgrimage to Canterbury. Realism to characterization. Like, his actual life is revealed not only in the plenty and variety of his pilgrims, but especially in their normality. His character perfectly life-size, only the life of Bath seems larger. Living characters. Many of the characters in the prologue seem almost to leap out of the page because of the description appear to tumble out just as they came into the narrator's mind. The effect as if we were listening to an eyewitness pouring out his news without pausing to reflect and to rearrange it in a logical order. And here the characters as types, as individuals, and the physical appearance of the character. Like the significant that Chaucer presents the prologue in one knight, one squire, one yeoman, one monk, one frat, and so on. Dryden was the one of the first to note how all pilgrims in prologue are distinguished from each other, not only in their inclinations but in their very physiognomies and persons. Chaucer has tried to link the physical appearance of a character with his moral qualities, thus the apparently naturalistic detail of the gap tooth of wife of Bath is lifted from the physiognomy manuals to serve as a symbol of her lusty vagrancy. The diseased skin of the summoner is an indication of his inner corruption and debauchery. Universality. Dryden has complimented Chaucer for the universality of his characters. Like Blake observed that Chaucer's pilgrims are the characters which compose all ages and nations. Every age is a Canterbury pilgrimage. Nun's Priest Tale, which can be abbreviated as NPT. NPT collocates a number of stories, some of them dream stories told by the cook and the priest. The widow and the protagonist of the story, of the other story, is contrasted once with the cock and the nun by implication. As the storyteller is a priest, the story is an aptly sermon. Most of this sermon is given at the end of the story. The moral, the defense poetry had traditionally been that it is both entertainment and edification. And for the reflection, the description of human setting of the fable is reflective or normative. For the mock heroic, NPT is primarily a fable and a fable that is intrinsically mock heroic, for it assumes as an identity or parallelism between animals and humans. Comedy. Comedy is an essential aspect of the form of the tale. It is not mere sugarcoating for the sermon. The pure fun and humor of the fable is the superficial comic element. And when it comes to the dream, dream is a fiction. Like fiction is like a dream or a daydream. The use of dream in fiction is therefore doubly insubstantial. Dreams have always exercised in the human mind, and the moral of the tale is no man should be into reachless of dreams, and some dreams are to be dreaded. The major themes of the tale are simple life and the plain diet, the medico-scientific view of dreams contrasted with popular superstitious view, the reflection on murder or homicide, man-women relationship, free will and predetermination, the reflection of flattery, the role of cautious, destiny, inescapable fortune, sudden turns. Speech, dialogue, reflection and narration in NPT. On the primary level, the Nun's Priest Tale is a brilliant and complex exposure of vanity, self-esteem and self-indulgence through the mock heroic treatment as a beast fable on the secondary level. The Nun's Priest joins the discussions of the pilgrims on poverty, women's advice to merchant reality and marriage. He is also representing in contrast between the widow and the chanticleer, a veiled comment on his position, the prioress finally on the level of involuntary revelation. B falls into the pedantry that he is ridiculating and uncovering for a moment in his confusion of feelings of a misogynist dependent on a woman. NPT is a dramatic tale. The action here is more verbal and than non-verbal. Wasteland, T.S. Eliot. While calling T.S. Eliot's poetry, the music of ideas, IAD chats, makes the following comments on his poetry. When he discusses several aspects of the wasteland, in particular to the critical question in all cases is whether the poem worth the trouble it entails. For the wasteland, this is a considerable, there is a miss westerns from ritual to romance to read and its astral trimming to be discarded. It illuminates his persistent concern with sex. The problem of our generation as a religion was the problem of the last then, is the central position of the Tiresias in the poem to be puzzled out of the cryptic form of the note which Eliot writes on the point that is just a little tiresome. It in the earlier poems, this logical freedom appears occasionally. Discuss the title of poem Wasteland. A great poet, while writing himself, should write of his time. Eliot's Wasteland expresses the mood of weariness and the despair of post-war Europe. Eliot gives us the horrid picture of despair-ridden humanity, thereby giving a sort of detached commentary on the disintegration of post-war civilization. His poems and poetic dramas deal with the condition of human souls, which are always in state of anxiety and in a state of irredeemable crisis, and a spiritual approach to life, human mind devoid of hope and faith, sex in the modern world mechanical and sterile, a gamer of chess, a neurasthenic episode. Hope of past and sterile, religious affirmation of life, the only remedy. Themes and art of the poem Wasteland. It is related to various St. Patrick wastelands in modern times. The wasteland is a religion, like it's of religion where there are but no water. It is of spirit where all the moral springs have dried up. It is of reproduction instead of sex have become a means of physical satisfaction rather than the source of regeneration. The poet communicates to the reader in his own sense of anarchy and futility that he finds everywhere to the contemporary world. Myth, imaginary and symbolism. Eliot uses the symbolistic technique to express a complex and descended civilization. His symbolism is predominantly traditional and so comparatively easy to understand. Like most of his writings were centered around the basic theme of birth, death and rebirth. Triumph of the Life, P.B. Shelley. Like discussing briefly about Shelley of Romanticism emerged as the Romantic movement or criticism in the last quarter of 18th century in Germany as criticism of prevailing neoclassical models which emphasize the mechanical and impersonal style of the literature. Rationalism is regarded by them as greatest value and poetry for them is only a craft of Dr. Joe Moon Wright. The business of the poet is to examine not the individual but the species. He must neglect the minute discrimination. Shelley's Skylark is a product of quivering imagination. like the bird has been compared with the cloud of fire. Shelley, a romantic poet. Politically and socially, the romantics in England supported republicanism, liberty and equality of the individuals. Shelley, 1792 and 1827, was a radical and unorthodox in his views and writings. His works contain metaphysics, radicalism, clothed in beautiful lyrics, and human passion and melancholy. Imagination. The Romantics criticized the rationalistic aesthetic of 18th century as mechanical, operating in the human mind. Inspiration and his forms of poetry. Critical summary of the poem. Like the incomplete poem in triplets, he met his untimely death while writing his poem. So the long poem of 540 lines comes to an abrupt end with "Then what is life?" Then it remains fragmentary poem, yet regarded by critics as Shelley's masterpiece. T.S. Eliot calls it Shelley's finest work. Carl Baker says that "Triumph of Life" is filled with solemn music and charged with deep melancholy. It is more nearly mature in the inward control and majestically dignified in its quiet outward demeanor. A romantic and humanitarian, poet who believed in liberty and love. Poetry as an expression of imagination. The title of the poem suggested theme. Hyperion, Keats, the critical appreciation. The Keats Hyperion is a fragment but very significant. It deals with the story of dethronement of titans by the Olympians. Keats wanted to raise the poem to the epic grandeur of Milton's Paradise Lost, but it does not come anywhere near Milton's poem. It has only an elevated style, but two fundamental characteristics of an epic: great action and great characters are lacking. Theme of the struggle between old order and new. Like Keats interwove into its fiber his entire philosophy of life, and will be loved and remembered for the depth of its thought and feelings of the message Keats conveys. It is the older order must yield a place to a new, and the struggle between titans and the Olympians assumes an allegorical significance in the light of the struggle between the haves and have-nots during the French Revolution. Themes of the beauty as creative force, personal element in the poem. Analyze Hyperion as an epic. Like the Keats Hyperion as an epic and his life of action. Epic is a narrative poem or organic in structure, dealing with the great actions and great characters in the dignified style. Characters do not rise to great height, and the style, the lyrical quality, weakens the character of the epic. The poem is lovable, but the imitation and reminiscence of the Mitten, a memorable literary piece. Discuss Hyperion as a political allegory. Like, what is the meaning of allegory? Hyperion is an allegory means that it has multiple meaning, and the real purpose of the writer is quite different from what it appears to the eyes. Allegory and the political representation Like, as a matter of fact, it is quite obvious that during the political repression, it is an extremely risky step to criticize the government or the powers to be. Writers resort and allegorical stories. The artists are sensitive lot and they cannot remain quiet when nation is facing crisis and there is no way out. They may wish to censure the government but cannot do for fear of retaliatory action by the government. The romantic writers wrote for a cause of the oppressed and the view convey implicitly and not explicitly. The Saturn, Titans of the Saturn represent the ancient regime and political system before the French Revolution. Saturn is led by others and a female deity. Dethronement of Saturn means replacement. An epistle of Dr. Arbuthnot Pope's self-dramatization in the poem. Like self-justification and defense, Pope's professed purpose in writing an epistle to Dr. Arbuthnot, as he states that in the advertisement to the poem, was to supply to his readers true and accurate information about his person, his morals, and his family. The autobiographical part, one of three divisions in the poem. A born poet encouraged by parents to write poetry. And defense of his satire on moral basis. He idealizes himself as a man and a poet. Portraits of the poem. Portraits of the minor poets revealing the Pope's grudge and malice. The most sustained, libelous, obscene, vulgar attack on the Lord Harvey. A flattened and personification of his own contradictions. George Bubble Coddington and Earl of Halifax satired in that. Characterization. Imagery in the poem. Paradise Lost. Analyze Kubla Khan. Kubla Khan was first published in the charitable volume of 1816. It is a masterpiece of the type of poetry which depends entirely for its success upon the pure pleasure it gives to the reader. The beauty of the form, color and varying rhythm by Kubla Khan then is a mere fragment that is incomplete, and this fact should be born in the mind when we judge it as a poem. Kubla Khan is a wild dream poem, and therefore it is an imagery that is appropriate, characterized by picturesque vagueness. Dejection on Ode. Goblin Market. Prelude. Sailing to Byzantium. Lapis Lazuli. With some weddings. Metaphysical poetry. This is a very important question of metaphysical poetry from T.S. Eliot. Like, it is a revolt against the romantic conventionalism of Elizabethan love poetry. The term metaphysical was applied to the poetry of Donner and his followers, first by Dryden and then by Dr. Johnson. Dr. Johnson borrowed Dryden's idea and in his Life of Coverley called Coverley a poet of metaphysical school of dawn. The term metaphysical denotes, according to the Saints Bury, the habitat common to this express something after something behind, the simple obvious first sense and suggestion of a subject. Metaphysical means beyond physical. The term is rightly applied to the poets like Don Colley, Herbert and Marvel. As in their poetry, there is the habit of always seeking express something after something behind. Contribution of poets to literature. Flea. Good Maro. Canonization. Canonization is a poem again by John Donne, whose poetry is marked by sparkling wit, beautiful fancies and metaphor, and deep personal tone. He is recognized as the greatest of the so-called metaphysical poets, whose works were full of unconventional and far-fetched images, concepts drawn from the most unlikely sources. His poetry exhibited a dramatic power and an individuality. The theme of this canonization is the love, which is selfless and saintly affection as a worth of respect or worship. Donne's love is both of body and soul. Victorian period in literature. Modernist poets versus postmodernist poets. Lycidas. It is about Milton's search for answers to the mystic questions of a worth of life and unpredictability of death. The poet presents here the two poets like shepherds who try to look deep into the mystery of life and death.